When Titanic and her sister ship Olympic were built in 1911, they were the largest and safest ships afloat. And yet Titanic sank on her maiden voyage from Southampton to New York on the 15th of April, 1912. Of over 2,200 passengers and crew, only 705 survived. All the rest were lost.
There was the loss of the Empress of Ireland in 1913, and then during the First World War, there was a loss of Lusitania. And then much later in the Second World War, there was Wilhelm Gustloff. But Titanic is the quintessential shipwreck in the minds of the public. It has all the drama, all the tragedy. And that's really what Titanic represents.
The story is told and retold in a constant stream of books and films. Some of the stories are true, many are myths. Time Watch tries to unravel the reality from the fiction and account for the public's seemingly endless fascination with Titanic. There are many myths surrounding the Titanic, but the central myth, the myth which underpins all the rest, was first told in Belfast, in the shipyard where she was built.
Well, when I was a wee boy growing up in Belfast, my father was working in the shipyard. He did all the lovely woodwork on the ships. And he kept telling me about this great ship that he was helping to build called the Titanic. So one Sunday, he took me down to the Queen's Road, to the shipyard, and he told me to look up, and I saw the great Titanic in the gantry. It was a huge piece of steel. It seemed to reach the sky. It was so high. And there seemed to be no end of it. It was so long. And I said to Dad, how could that big ship stay up in the water? And his words to this day I'll never forget, how significant they were. Son, that big ship will always stay up in the water. In Belfast, we called it the unsinkable ship.
She was the largest ship afloat, her decks rising as high as an 11-story building. And she was safe. There were 15 watertight bulkheads. If water got into one, it couldn't get into the next. To all intents and purposes, Titanic was unsinkable. And yet, she sank. And in that moment, Titanic captured the public's imagination and has held it ever since. But why?
People see the 1912 aura where people dressed for dinner and they had manners and everything was the Gilded Age. And today that's all gone. Well, I think the Titanic had something like 8 courses for a particular meal. This is what captivates the people of today. They don't know such things. People today are holding Titanic dinners now with the same menus that they had then. To be a part of an era that will never live again.
The stories which captivated a public's attention in 1912 mostly came from the glittering first-class passenger list. Colonel and Mrs. Astor, worth a cool £80 million. Mr. B. Guggenheim, the famous millionaire playboy. The young and beautiful Countess of Rothes, with her cousin and maid. Mr. and Mrs. Strauss, owners of Macy's department store in New York. Mrs. Molly Brown, the rags-to-riches story from Denver, Colorado. And Jack Thayer, travelling with his parents, leading members of Philadelphia society. Also on board for this maiden voyage was Mr. Bruce Ismay, chairman and managing director of the White Star Line, which owned Titanic. And Captain Smith himself, the Commodore, earning £1,200 a year where other captains were lucky to get half that amount.
Titanic is a wonderful example, a cross-section, if you like, of society in 1912, where you have the very top decks of the ship are devoted for first class, and then below them is second class accommodation, below them is third class accommodation. Practically on the waterline, and right beneath that, in the bowels of the ship, along with the boilers and the reciprocating engines of the turbine and where all the cargo was kept, you have the crew, the firemen and the trimmers. So you really have a miniature city afloat, but also within that city, the class system itself.
All were embarked on the most luxurious ship ever built, more like a grand hotel than a ship, with its opulent staterooms, panelled smoking rooms, fashionable dining rooms, first-class cabins with four-poster beds and fireplaces with real coal, and a gym, swimming pool and Turkish baths, plus the Marconi wireless room, so that passengers could send and receive messages through the very latest invention of the wireless telegraph. There were over 800 officers and crew, some 500 above decks, and 320 below. And they too would have their stories to tell. Sid Sedenary's father was assistant to the third-class chief steward.
My father, he'd already served on the Adriatic and the Olympic, so this was, in effect, a promotion. But he got fitted out, going on to a new ship. When you consider that his pay was £5 a month, and I imagine he must have gone into debt. But, of course, moving on to the Titanic was a security future, as they thought.
Bob Burr's grandfather was the steward in the first-class saloon, serving the Countess of Rothes.
My grandmother was a passenger being served at the table that Bob's grandfather was on. She was going to join my grandfather, who was already in America. She had a cousin as a companion and her personal maid.
Well, he was very excited at the time because he'd been on the Adriatic and went transferred to the Oceanic, and then when the Titanic came about, being the largest ship at the time and most luxurious, he was fortunate enough to go on the Titanic, and he'd worked himself up from second class, and he became a first-class saloon steward and served the Countess of Rothes. So the last letter from the Titanic was posted at Queenstown, and it mentions that he's got a five table and he's serving a young lady, Braithwaite.
She was a first-class passenger, certainly, enjoying what they took to be what they were expecting, everybody waiting on them hand and foot, literally.
At table number 8 was the flamboyant Mrs. Molly Brown of Denver, Colorado, who later became known as the unsinkable Molly Brown.
Molly was sort of a self-made woman, which was something very different than most of the first-class women aboard Titanic. The Browns made their money in Leadville, Colorado, and they struck the richest vein of gold that had ever been found in the United States up until that time. They did come to Denver and try to reach the highest levels of society that they could, and Molly would always eclipse the other ladies in her opera gowns and in her dress, but she didn't get invited necessarily to the most exclusive society parties. It wasn't until her heroism in the Titanic disaster that the women of the Sacred 36, which was the most elite of Denver society families, invited her to a luncheon in her honor and really welcomed her with open arms.
On Sunday, April the 14th, life on board Titanic was proceeding according to plan. Sunday service was over, and the first-class passengers were promenading on deck. The sea was calm, the sky was clear. Only the sharpening air signaled the approaching ice field. Down in third class, it was comfortable and warm. The White Star Line made its real profit from third-class passengers and mail. Titanic had taken on over 100 Irish immigrants at Queenstown and another 275 of all nationalities at Cherbourg. Below decks, the engineers and stokers and trimmers were making sure Titanic held to her speed of 22 knots. In 1912, everyone knew their place. Titanic was organized strictly according to class.
Titanic represents a whole of society, from the very rich to the very poor. And remember, the poor people on Titanic, they really were poor, because these weren't just poor travelers. They were people looking for a new life, a new world in America.
A life free of class distinctions. On Titanic, the first-class deck was for first-class passengers only. On that fateful Sunday in 1912, passengers were unaware that ice warnings had been coming into the Marconi wireless room throughout the afternoon and evening. Jack Phillips, the wireless operator, was overworked, sending passengers private messages. The ice warnings were an irritating interruption. He passed them to his assistant, Bride, who took them to Captain Smith and the officers on the bridge. At about 9 p.m., Titanic entered the ice field. Ahead lay icebergs as high as skyscrapers and as solid as rock. They were 3,000 years old and weigh 500,000 tons. But Captain Smith viewed icebergs as a natural hazard and steamed on. At 10 p.m., the lookouts changed in the crow's nest. Fred Fleet scanned the horizon. He saw nothing. But at 11:40, the iceberg loomed out of the darkness and Titanic hit it. Fleet raised the alarm, but it was too late. Below decks, the engineers and stokers went into frantic action. On the upper decks, people hardly looked up. There'd only been a slight shudder. Some went on deck to see if they could spot an iceberg. There was no cause for concern. After all, Titanic was unsinkable. But the iceberg had sliced clean through five watertight bulkheads. It was only a matter of time before Titanic would sink. And so the myths of heroism and villainy began, and have been told and retold ever since.
The myths of this Titanic started immediately as soon as the first news came by wireless to the U.S. and Britain and other countries. In fact, one of the stunning things about the Titanic disaster is that there were full-blown stories before there was any reliable information at all. Newspapers across the United States were already running a story explaining that John Jacob Astor and the Strausses and Guggenheim had stood back heroically while they ushered women and children into lifeboats to be saved. And nobody had told anybody anything about these things. And so it was what was expected. It was what people needed to hear.
In the wireless room, Phillips sent out frantic SOS messages. But few ships had a wireless set, and the liner Carpathia, which was coming to the rescue, was some 50 miles away, too far to reach the Titanic in time. But the passengers knew nothing of this and continued their evening as usual. The Countess of Rothes had retired to her cabin with her cousin and her maid.
We struck the iceberg at 11:45 on Sunday night, and until 1 o'clock, no one realized any danger or really knew what had happened. Then the order came to be dressed and have lifebelts on. I sent Maoni up at once when the order came, but she wanted to wait for us, which was grand at a moment like that.
So they went up on deck. But throughout, of course, they were all convinced that the ship was unsinkable. So danger and panic and fear didn't enter the thing at all.
When you're in service, your attention is to look after others rather than look after yourself, perhaps. In those days, it was women and children first, and the men stood back and did what they could.
Up on deck, officers began to organize the lifeboats, women and children first. Some third-class passengers got up on deck, but most were trapped five decks below, with little chance of getting out.
It's the officers and the first-class men who have a monopoly on heroism in this story. Steerage passengers, at best, aren't talked about at all. At worst, are described as the crazed crowds who are trying to crowd into the boats and have to be beaten back by the officers. This myth of first-class heroism is everywhere in the culture in 1912.
But the figures tell a different story. 38% of all first-class passengers were lost, 58% of second-class, but 74% of third-class. In fact, more men from first-class survived than children from third-class. But despite this disaster, Captain Smith still became the greatest hero of them all, the captain who went down with his ship.
It's quite an extraordinary myth that has grown up around Captain Smith. And it's so difficult to say things against it, because when you've got a bronze statue to somebody and books written about them, even poetry, stories of Captain Smith swimming in the water with a baby in his arms and putting the baby in the lifeboat and then waving goodbye, saying, good luck, lads, and he's never seen again. All these stories, all these myths grew up around Captain Smith, blinding the public to the astonishing truth that Captain Smith failed everybody on that ship that night.
Smith was aware of the ice warning messages, yes, because there was a large number that came in, very large number. In the Marconi archives, there are some 140 ice warning messages, not all to the Titanic, but to the various ships involved, and there were about 20 ships in the vicinity. Captain Smith was aware of the ice situation, but he tended to ignore them. He preferred to continue at some 21 and a half knots, almost full speed, in a very serious situation.
You couldn't blame Captain Smith. Captain Smith had died. The myth factory says that he died like a man. He died a hero's death. They even had records produced, Be British, Stand By Your Post, singing songs about Captain Smith, this heroic shipmaster that did everything he possibly could to save his passengers.
Every man at his post as the big ship went down to save precious lives, there we find them. They died like heroes true. Now something we must do. For the wives and little ones they left behind them.
The idea that dying on Titanic made a man a hero was developed further in Hollywood in the 1950s.
It was told differently in the 1950s. For example, in the 1953 movie Titanic with Clifton Webb and Barbara Stanwyck, even though it's clearly set in 1912, it's very much about 1950s issues.
Now put on warm things, everybody.
It's a very American film. It's a story about domesticity, about American wholesomeness, about what constitutes healthy and happy family and marriage.
Lifeboats? And you say there's no danger?
Julia, I'm afraid you don't...
The Clifton Webb character, this sort of pseudo-aristocrat who's been corrupted by a life of frivolity, and his wife, Barbara Stanwyck, takes their two kids, runs off from Europe and wants to bring them back to the wholesome American Midwest, to the heartland, where they'll grow up uncorrupted.
Remember, number six. Well, I believe we're ready.
In the 1953 film, they invented a fictional story that would tell a tale that resonated with American audiences in particular.
Officer, officer.
The Clifton Webb character has been a bad husband. But in the end, he redeems himself, of course, by saving lots of women and children.
She'll take care of you.
And even though Clifton Webb goes down with the ship, in effect, he saved their marriage and saved their American family by doing so.
But for every hero in the Titanic story, there is a villain. And in 1912, the chief villain was Mr. J. Bruce Ismay, chairman of the White Star Line.
Well, the flip side of the first class men's monopoly on heroism is that if you were a man and you got off this ship alive, then you had some explaining to do. And so the villain of the story is J. Bruce Ismay, who was the director of the White Star Line and got into a lifeboat and got away and was widely vilified for doing it, and it actually ruined his life.
The press themselves wanted to find somebody to blame for the loss of the ship. Those largely came from papers controlled by William Randolph Hearst. And he was a newspaper baron in the United States, a very powerful man. And he and Bruce Ismay had met many, many years before. And the two men had fallen out. And then when Titanic sank, I think Hearst thought, well, this was a golden opportunity to get my own back on Bruce Ismay. And he did it with great relish.
The worst accusation against Ismay was that as chairman of the White Star Line, he was responsible for the lack of lifeboats on Titanic. In fact, the Board of Trade Regulations had allowed this, but the newspapers blamed Ismay for it and for much else besides.
And then you had passengers on the ship, on the Titanic, saying, well, yes, I overheard a conversation where Bruce Ismay was saying that we are going to get into New York a day ahead of schedule. And some of the passengers related these stories to the press. So suddenly Titanic is not only being controlled by Bruce Ismay, who's just a passenger, now he's somehow an auxiliary captain on board, but he's also making poor Captain Smith drive his ship faster than he really wanted to, thereby indirectly causing the loss of Titanic. Another myth that was created, reinforced again and again and again by newspaper stories. And it's William Randolph Hearst who's responsible for nicknaming Bruce Ismay J. Brute Ismay, and saying that the White Star flag should be changed to that of the Yellow Liver. All the other myths surrounding Ismay came after that, a suggestion that he wore a dress or in some way disguised himself, or that he demanded to get into a lifeboat. That never happened.
The crime really was that his life was saved and that of many other people was lost. He undoubtedly did wish at times that he had not survived. The personal abuse that was heaped on him was to him and would have been to anyone extraordinarily hurtful. And the fact that much of it was unfair and fabricated must have made the hurt even greater to him, I think.
But the fact remained. There weren't enough lifeboats to go around. Nothing like enough. Only 20. Enough for 1,178 people, and there were over 2,200 people on board. Who should be saved and who should die? In 1912, it was women and children first. Second Officer Lightoller was organizing lifeboats on the port side. Lightoller was another officer hero, and his story quickly became part of the myth of Titanic, dramatically retold in the 1950s film A Night to Remember, with Kenneth Moore playing Lightoller.
1950s Britain, it was so important to have films that would make the British public feel good after the horrors of the Second World War. What better opportunity than to have a real British hero? But the way that Lightoller was portrayed in the film, it's a complete distortion of what actually happened that night. Nobody in their right mind would fill a lifeboat with women and children. And when there are no more women and children left, not fill up the remaining spaces with men. And yet Lightoller did that.
Worse still, some 1,000 third-class passengers and crew were trapped below, desperately trying to find a way up onto the boat deck. As they climbed from deck to deck, the water seeped up behind them. By 1:30, Titanic was beginning to go down, and there were few lifeboats left.
I think the whole thing was a shambles. It was quite clear there was no provisions at all for the event when it came.
No one knows whether third-class passengers were kept below on captain's orders, but the fact is, there were no lifeboats left.
See, third-class passengers never had access, like the second and third, and they were in the extreme ends of the ship. So everything was really against them.
From the moment that Smith realised that Titanic was going to sink, Smith's command disintegrated on board Titanic. I think he had some sort of mental collapse. I think the magnitude of the disaster, the coming disaster, was too much for him to take. You know, here he is, the captain of the world's most famous passenger ship. He's the commodore of the White Star Line. How could this possibly happen?
No one knew or cared in the mounting chaos as women and children were put into the lifeboats. But now was Molly Brown's chance to make her mark and go down in history. She grabbed an oar and began to row. By the 1950s, she'd become the subject of a Broadway musical, and by the 1960s, her story had made it to Hollywood.
Molly got the unsinkable nickname right after the disaster. When she came off the ship and the reporters met her, they asked her, "How did you survive?" And she said, "Oh, typical Brown luck. I'm unsinkable.
I ain't ready to die. Hell, I'm just learning how to live." There you are, honey.
Americans love a big, colorful hero who's larger than life.
Did I ever tell you?
I think the Molly Brown story is really an American story of the self-made person. They love the idea that maybe Denver society was stacked against her and that she prevailed despite them all and really showed them.
Not with Molly Brown on board. That ship may be down, but not me. I'm unsinkable. You!
And then, of course, the myth that everybody would love to believe is that she and her husband got back together after the sinking of the Titanic when she was nearly lost. That did not really occur. She and Mr. Brown remained separated. They decided that the Molly Brown film needed to be a love story, so they had to give a payoff at the end. And as you notice, there are no children shown in the story, but of course, by the time the Titanic sank, Molly's two children were grown and she had one grandchild, my father.
As Molly Brown rowed away from the sinking Titanic, the Countess of Rothes was still on deck, waiting her turn.
Well, my grandmother and her companion found the captain putting people into the different lifeboats, and she was told to get into lifeboat number 8 with her companion and her maid, which they did. And then the lifeboat was lowered. Not, I must say, full, but they were lowered because you had to get the boats away somehow.
Since there were only two crewmen, the Countess took the tiller. As for Mrs. Strauss of Macy's store, she refused to leave her husband. "We've been together for 40 years, and we'll stay together now," she said. Mr. Guggenheim went to change into his evening dress. He meant to die like a gentleman. Mrs. Thayer got into a lifeboat watched from the deck by her husband and son, Jack. Not long after, Jack was separated from his father in the chaos. He never saw him again. Jack stood by the ship's rail and wondered what to do.
It must now have been about 1:50 a.m., and as far as we knew, the last boat had gone. So many thoughts passed so quickly through my mind. I thought of all the good times I had had, and of all the future pleasures I would never enjoy, of my father and mother, of my sisters and brother. I looked at myself as though from some far-off place. I sincerely pitied myself. It was now 2:15 a.m. We could see the water creeping up the deck. As I recall it, the lights were still on even then. To see all the men covered with the dirt and grime of the boiler room lined up on deck awaiting orders was a grand, inspiring sight. Not a single engineering officer or engineer was saved.
Jack finally leapt off Titanic and survived, but not the band. They played on and went down with the ship. Just 7 of the 1,503 who died that night.
My father's body was found on the 24th of April and buried on the 25th at sea. At least we've got the satisfaction of knowing what did happen to him. Clearly, he got up on deck himself, as the watch indicates. Well, you can see it was about 10 to 2. And the last of the main lifeboats went at 1:45. So that's the time that he must have gone in the water. And I often wondered just what happened, but the ship's barber, when he gave evidence, he said he was helping with the lifeboats, and that suddenly the Titanic gave a lurch forward, and he was pitched into the sea. And he said eventually, when he looked at his watch, it stopped at 10 to 2. So I don't know, speculation, I know, but I wondered if that's what happened to my father.
Why did no one come to the rescue? It was Captain Lord of the California who found himself blamed. The California was a medium-sized freight steamer, and Lord, a captain of many years' experience. Lord had taken the precaution of stopping at the edge of the ice field at about 10 p.m., and he remained stationary for the next 9 hours. He also got his wireless operator, Evans, to send out ice warnings, including one to the Titanic. And yet the British inquiry blamed him, and the myth of Lord's guilt persists to this day.
He was accused of being within 8 to 10 miles of the Titanic when she sank, and he did nothing. He stayed in his chart room asleep and did nothing. And it was said by the Court of Inquiry, by Lord Mersey, president of the court, that he could have rescued all the passengers had he gone when he was called.
Lord Mersey came to the inquiry determined to avoid a national scandal. A barrage of lawyers and experts were assembled to look into the facts. But one fact which conveniently escaped attention was that the Board of Trade had allowed the Titanic to go to sea with only 20 lifeboats, enough for less than half the passengers and crew. Mersey's tactic seemed to have been to divert attention to Captain Lord. The case rested on a light seen from Titanic at about midnight. It remained on the horizon for some time, then moved off. This was the California, the British inquiry suggested, completely ignoring the fact that the California was stationary for 9 hours.
He came to rest just on the edge of the ice floe and lay stopped there all night. The Titanic, which had had all the ice reports and probably more than he had had, just steamed straight on at probably 22 knots.
And I personally think that Captain Lord has had a pretty raw deal, because at 11 o'clock on the 14th, he did give instructions to his wireless operator to send a message to the Titanic to say that they were stationary some 12 miles away and surrounded by ice.
What the inquiry didn't go into were there were literally scores of other ships around. I mean, you'd think there was, to judge by the myths, you'd think there was only the Titanic, Californian. There were scores of other ships which were never investigated.
The unsuspecting Lord arrived at the inquiry as just another witness and with no lawyer. By the time he left, he was more or less blamed for the rescue disaster.
So this is very convenient for the British government, the Board of Trade, which was responsible for shipping, and it provided a very convenient scapegoat for the public to focus on.
Whilst Lord was unjustly blamed, Jack Phillips, the wireless operator who went down with the ship, became a hero. His hometown proudly honoured him with a memorial. But one inconvenient detail was omitted from the story, and it concerned the last ice warning received by Phillips at 11 p.m. from Evans on the California.
Phillips told the wireless operator on the California, "Keep out."
because he was sending rich passengers' messages. So Phillips was a very courageous man because he stayed at his post right until the very end as the ship was going down. I just think that he made a fatal error in not interrupting what he was doing at 11 o'clock, some 40 minutes before collision, and stopped sending important passengers' messages to Cape Race and go immediately to the bridge and tell the officer of the watch the situation. Then it was up to them.
This didn't stop Marconi, the inventor of the wireless telegraph, from cashing in on the story. As he waited at the dockside in New York for Bride, his surviving wireless operator, Marconi made sure he had a newspaperman with him to scoop the story.
Marconi was desperate to improve the share prices for his own company, and the Titanic disaster was a perfect vehicle to do that. He was very keen to show how wireless had effectively saved over 700 people because Titanic had the ability to call for assistance. If she didn't have that ability, then perhaps more people would have died. So Marconi made sure that the newspapers knew all about Jack Phillips.
And so another story of duty and self-sacrifice hit the headlines and added to the drama of Titanic, the story which sold ever more newspapers.
The very first newspapers became collector's items in their own right. Many of the big publishers would produce memorial editions, and they came out perhaps 4 or 5 days after the ship sank. And these would contain lurid stories of survivors. Most of them had just been cobbled together by journalists because they had to have something to write.
This is the Daily Mirror of Tuesday, April the 16th. Remember, the Titanic sank early on the Sunday. And this is the headline. Everyone safe. So just imagine the feelings of all the relatives when later on Tuesday they learned the truth. One can only just imagine.
My grandmother received a telegram saying, Burr 34, Victoria Road, Wolston, much regret, Burr not saved. So, you know, after all the excitement of the largest liner of the day, sailing from Southampton on the 10th of April 1912 to hitting the iceberg and receiving a rather dramatic telegram. My grandmother lived till she was 98, and she was a widow right through to her final death. They'd been married about roughly 3 years, perhaps. And the contents of the love letters, you can imagine that it mentions that he's away for 18 days and that he'd be coming back and seeing his son again and seeing his wife. So it's sort of ended up, I'm afraid. It's a very sad story.
In 1912, it was very, very much women and children first. So my grandmother survived, I'm happy to say. Primarily, of course, she was a lady and a first-class passenger. And she didn't die till 1956, so I knew her quite well while I was growing up. And she was a remarkable lady.
Social differences were very pronounced in those days. I mean, an example of that is when the bodies were picked up, the first-class bodies were put in coffins and the rest in canvas bags. So it still carried on after death.
As for the Titanic herself, it was at the moment of her death that she gained her immortality.
We talk about the myth, but the story, the legend of Titanic, began the moment that ship sank. And I think that word, Titanic, has captured people's imagination from 1912 up to the present day.
Today, there are Titanic societies throughout the world. But the original society was started in 1963 by Ed Kamuda in Springfield, Massachusetts.
because we have so much material here, and most of it has a story behind it, and that's the important part. You can take something from the gravesite, a broken cup or a dish or a piece of luggage, and if you don't know who it belongs to, it's just a broken dish, a broken cup. But this is real history.
Shelf are some examples of souvenirs, and many souvenirs that came out right after the Titanic disaster. We have here a play a piano roll. The Wreck of the Titanic is the title. And then we have a glass slide.
A lantern slide. And of course, as they would play the music, they would show the slides and the screen.
And we have a record, a 78 record, if anyone really knows what they are anymore. It's called The Sinking of the Titanic. And there was a lot of souvenirs that came out at the time, sheet music.
It was sad when the great ship went down. My sweetheart went down with the Titanic.
In fact, I was just going through a Boston Herald. It was about April 19th, 1912. And the ad at the bottom of the paper was very interesting. Hustlers, come and get. They're ready. Titanic.
Now we would never do that. We would think how awful it would be to produce postcards showing a jet airliner striking a tower block. We would think that would be ghastly. I mean, you could imagine the person producing that would be hounded out of town, but not in 1912.
There were about 150 popular songs written in the year after the Titanic disaster. Then there are folk songs, which are transmitted orally and aren't recorded until later, until the 1930s. But there's every reason to believe that those songs were being sung within months, if not days, of the disaster itself.
Songs about heroes who died and heroes who lived. But in Southampton, the hometown of 637 crew members who were lost, there was nothing but grief.
There was hardly a street in the town and I hadn't lost a relative. In one school in Northam, in Southampton, one class, every child had lost a relative. The town must have been completely devastated. One really, you can't imagine how people felt.
Well, of course, life was going on as usual in Belfast, and the Titanic was on its way, and everybody was looking in the newspapers, photographs of the Titanic sailing on the Atlantic. And you know, I can remember vividly the day and the time my father heard the Titanic was sunk. And I remember we heard the little newspaper boy shouting outside, and he just couldn't believe it. He couldn't get the telegraph, the newspaper, quick enough. And he opened it, and he read these big headlines, Titanic sunk. And you know, I can remember it well. He just broke down, and he cried like a child.